Good morning, all of you. Today we'll discuss about the topic concrete technology. In this topic, we will have to discuss about types of Portland cement as per ASTM, American Society for Testing and Material. Aggregates, introduction about aggregates, their history, their past, and the present and the source of aggregates, classification of aggregates as per size. So the types of Portland cement as per the ASTM, American Society of Testing and Material, C150, there are different types of Portland cement which are manufactured to meet the requirements of specific purpose. So American Society of Testing and Materials have just listed out the various types of cement and their applications and purposes of use. Type 1, it is a normal kind of cement. Type 2, normal and air entering cement. Type 2, moderate sulfate resistance cement. Type 2A, moderate sulfate resistance and air entering cement. Type 3, high early strength cement. Type 4, type 3A, high early strength and air entering cement. Type 4, low heat of hydration cement. And type 5, high sulfate resistant cement. So we will study now one by one each of these cements. So we will start with type 1 cement. Type 1 cement, it is a general purpose cement. As I said earlier before in the last slide, that is a normal cement, ordinary Portland cement, OPC, which we have already discussed in the last lecture of concrete technology in the heading under types of cements. So this is used in pavements, or we can use this Portland cement making pavements, floors, reinforced concrete buildings, bridges, tanks, pipes, and etc. So there are umpteen number of applications of ordinary Portland cement, and we almost on average in every building use the ordinary Portland cement unless until specified for special cements. So it is for all users where special properties of other cement types are not required. So as I said earlier, that if there is a demand for certain type of cement other than the ordinary Portland cement, then there will be a specification. The client will specify prior that he or she or whatever the building that requires a special kind of cement will be taken. So at the time, the contractor will be binded to take the special type of cement other than concrete cement. So this is the applications of type 1 cement: road, pavement, building, bridges, and the high-rise buildings. Now, type 2 cement. It is used where precautions against moderate sulfate attack is important. So, in a way, it is a sulfate-resistant cement because it resists the sulfate attack. So, where the building which are situated near the coastlines where sea and oceans are there, so there we will have the moist air which contains sulfate in it, and the water which also have the sulfates, magnesium sulfate in it. So at there in the coastal areas, we have to use the solvent resistant cement. Also, where the places where there are the high concentration of sulfate in the ground waters. So what does it contain, sulfate? It contains not more than 8% of tricalcium aluminate. Just we have to lower down the amount of tricalcium aluminate, which is as per the specification is 8%. So type 2 cement, it generates less heat of hydration at a slower rate than type 1. So as I said, type 2 cement, which is we have already seen this sulfate resistant cement, generates less heat of hydration as compared to type 1, that is OPC cement, and therefore can be used in mass concreting or the mass structures like dams and all to build. Apart from the structures, heavy structures like dam, we can use it in heavy abutments and retaining walls. So due to less heat of hydration generation, it can be preferred in hot weather too. So this is the applications of type 2 cement, which is the pavement, the pipes and the bridge piers. So now type 3 cement. It is chemically and physically similar to type 1 cement, which is OPC, ordinary Portland cement, except that its particles have ground finer. So the particles of this cement is grounded and is more finer than the OPC, ordinary Portland cement. It provides higher yield strength at an early period, usually a week or less. So in this kind of cement, the difference between the OPC and this cement is that it provides early strength at an early period, usually a week or less. It is used when forms needed to be removed as soon as possible or when the structure must be put into service quickly. So when there is an urgent need to make a structure within the limited time, so we use this kind of cement because it sets early, so we can remove the formworks early and we can provide the facility as soon as possible. It is preferred in cold weather for reduction in the curing period. So as the curing period, is concerned, this kind of cement is preferred in the cold weather for reduction in curing period. The application of this is the precast bridges and the highway pavement. Type 4 cement. It is used where the rate and amount of heat generated from hydration must be minimized. So the use of this kind of cement is where the rate and amount of heat generated from hydration must be minimized. So where the heat of hydration should be less, this kind of cement is more useful. Or we use where we have to check the hydration, heat of hydration. It develops strength at a lower speed than other cement types. So this kind of cement develops less strength or the strength in lower rate than compared to OPC or other kind of cement. It is most suitable used in massive concrete structure such as large gravity dams where the temperature rise resulting from heat generated. So in mass concrete structure such as dams, if there is a high heat of hydration, then we have to take measures to lower down the heat of hydration, for which we have to install the pipes through which the chilled water is being served to the structure, so that it can gets heated, cooled down, and should and the proper amount of the temperature will be maintained for the exothermic reaction. So if this kind of cement which produces less heat of hydration will be very useful at the places where we have to build the gravity dams and we have to check the heat of hydration. So this is the dam and these are the big abutment of the structure. So now type 5 cement. It is used only in concrete exposed to severe sulfate action, principally where soils or groundwaters have a high sulfate content. Its high sulfate resistance is due to its low C3A content of about 4%. It is not resistant to acid and other highly corrosive substances. So this concrete is used in concrete exposed to the sulfate action. So this kind of cement is exposed to the sulfate action because it is more resistant to the sulfate. So and as it is resistant to sulfate, that's why we can use this kind of cement at places where we have more amount of sulfates in the places such as coastal areas. So now about the air entraining Portland cement, which we have seen in the contents 1A, 2A, and 3A. So these cements produce concrete with minute, well distributed and separate air bubbles, which improve the resistance to freeze thaw action and to scale caused by chemical applied force known as ice removal. So this kind of cements, which are named as air entering agents, we use this kind of cements where we have to take care of the freezing and thawing action of the environment, because such places where freezing and thawing action is extreme in nature, we have to use this kind of cement to that thing to give more life to the structure, because the freezing and thawing action will deteriorate the structure and will destroy its integrity. Now, white Portland cement, it has composition same as type 1, which is OPC, or type 3 cement, except that it has a color, white color instead of gray color. So this white Portland cement is more like white cement, which doesn't have which is almost having equal properties like as per the OPC, but it have a negligible amount of iron and magnesium oxides, which gives color to a ordinary Portland cement. So if we remove, or if we just lower down the amount, or just completely remove the iron and magnesium oxides from a ordinary Portland cement, we'll get this white Portland cement. So the primary use of this cement is for the architectural purposes. For the use of this structure, the cement is more in architectural purposes, purposes than the building, the structure building. If at all we use this kind of cement in our building, it will be very expensive cement, and that the cost of that building will be very high. That's why we just don't use this kind of cement and only use it for the ornamental purpose or architectural purpose. So the applications are like this: buildings and places. Now, the blended hydrolyzed cement. These cements are produced by intimately and uniformly blending the Portland cement and the byproduct materials such as blast furnace slag, fly ash, silica fume, and other pozzolana. So, the common thing in fly ash, silica fume, and pozzolana is silica. So if we add these fly ash, silica and pozzolana, so to make a blended hydrolyzed cement, we have to mix it intimately with the Portland cement. Such things such as fly ash, silica, fume, to mix these materials into Portland cement uniformly and intimate. So that mixture which comes out should be very intimate and should thoroughly mixed. That's why intimately word is used, because it is mixed thoroughly and for a long time, so that we cannot distinguish between the two different materials. So this is blended hydrolyzed cement. So these are the examples of blended cements. Now, the summary we have learned in last class and up to the types of the blended hydrolyzed cement. So in last lecture, we have seen the C3S, formation of C3S. So what was the properties of C3S? Hydrates, hardens rapidly. C3S hardens rapidly and is largely responsible for initial set and early strength. The early strength of cement is higher with the increased percentage of C3S. So as the percentage of C3S increases, the initial set and early strength increases. Now about C2S, the dicalcium silicate, hydrates and hardens slowly. This C2S compound, which is a Bogues compound, hydrates and hardens slowly. So it is mainly responsible for the later strength of the concrete. Contributes largely to strength increase at ages beyond 1 week. So it increases the strength of concrete after 1 week. So that's why it is responsible for the slower late strength of the concrete. Next is C3A, tricalcium aluminate. Liberates a large amount of heat during the first few days of the hydration and hardening. So C3A is a very reactive compound, Bose compound, formed after manufacturing of cement in the furnace. So this is very reactive and it liberates huge amount of heat in the first few days. So that's why if we lower down the amount of C3A in cement, we can produce a low heat of hydration cement. Also contributes slightly to the early strength of the element. So apart from C3S, it also contributes slightly in the strength of the concrete. Gypsum added to the cement slows down the hydration rate of C3A. So to make a cement proper cement, we have to especially OPC, ordinary potash cement, we have to lower down. We have to just control the reaction of C3A because it reacts, it's a reactive substance, it reacts in a flash. So to control down or to just lower down, slow down the rate of heat of hydration or its rate of its reaction with the water, we have to add gypsum in it. So gypsum control the rate of heat of hydration of C3A. Cements with low percentage of C3A are especially resistant to soil and waters containing sulfate. So if we lower down the value of C3A, low percentage of C3A, we will in a sense producing a resistant to sulfate. So that cement will be resistant to sulfate. So that's why in sulfate resistant cements, we make a cement which have a low percentage of C3A. Now C4AF does not play any significant role on the hydration. So C4AF tetra calcium aluminum ferrite, it doesn't play that much role or its role is insignificant as far as the strength of the concrete and the properties of the concrete are concerned. First cement used by the Egyptians and Harappa Mohenjo-daro. So in the history of mankind, we have seen the traces of the use of cement by Egyptians and Harappa Mohenjo-daro in the very back in the BC. So it is in the history. Then after Egyptians and Harappa Mohenjo-daro, Romans added the blood in cement or just modified the cement which was used by Egyptian Harappa Mohenjo-daro civilizations, and they added the blood in cement to increase its durability. So Romans have used cement with, they have added the blood in the cement to increase its durability. In India in 1974, Indian Cement Limited made Portland cement. So in India, first time Portland cement is made in 1940 by the India Cement Limited. How the cement is formed? Calcareous material, which the calcareous materials are materials which have more calcium, and argillaceous material which has silica in it, they combine and put into furnace in a heat of around 1200 to 1500, in between 1200 degree to 1500 degree, which forms cement. So the outcome will be cement clinkers. Heat of hydration increases with increase in C3A and C3S and decrease with increase in C2S. So as I said earlier, just two slides before that, the heat of hydration, if C3 amount is increased, heat of hydration will increase. If C3 is increased, heat of hydration will increase. But if C2S is increased, then heat of hydration is low or will decrease. Why? Because C2S is considered as that C2S compound gives is for the later strength of the concrete made out of this cement. C3A reacts with water in presence of gypsum, gives eutrophic. So the eutrophic formation happens when the C3A reacts with gypsum. That's why we add gypsum in the ordinary Portland cement to lower down the C3A, because the heat of hydration of C3A, because that C3A at the time will be reacting with the gypsum to form eutrophic, which is unstable, and then after unstable, to get into after the gypsum finishes, it will react with further C3A, then it will react with C3A to give monosulfate, which is far more stable than eutrophic. OPC, higher grades gives advantage of less consumption of cement but increase the cost of cement. As the there are many grades in OPC, ordinary potent cement, which are 33 grade, 43 grade, 53 grade. If we use 43 grade or 53 grade, as the grade of the concrete increases, the consumption of cement will be less because we will be getting more concrete strength with the use of less cement compared to the OPC, the lower grade cement. But at the same time, it will be costly. But as far as the total construction is concerned, the use of higher grades will be more beneficial for a project than the lower grades. Sulfate resistant cement contains low C3A content maximum to 5%. And if and the same C3A content also means in some places or in some special cement we use 8% as per the ASTM C150. So there is a different thing that it should be minimum 55%, maximum it will go to 8%. So ASTM use 8% and as per the Indian standard we use at 5%. Oil well cement used in high pressure conditions where pressure will be of range 1300 kg per centimeter square and high temperature in range 75 degree for grouting purposes. Slag cement uses 25 to 85% of slag content. Essentially a low heat cement. So it is the cement is a low heat cement. Initial strength due to clinker fraction and final strength due to slag fraction. So in a slag cement where we use slag 25 to 85%, it is essentially a low heat cement. And the initial strength of this cement is due to the clinker fraction and the final strength due to the slag fraction. PPC, the pozzolana coated cement, uses 10 to 25% of pozzolana. Expensive cement shrinkage is very less. So expensive cement is that, for example, if we make a cube of OPC and the same cube is made of same specifications made by this expensive cement, the shrinkage of this cement will be the cube will be less than the OPC. That's why we call it as an expensive cement because it doesn't expand but it have less shrinkage than compared to the OPC if you make a same specification a cube. In it, 80 to 20 parts of sulfo aluminate is added to 100 parts of Portland cement. So in this kind of cement we add 80 to 20 parts of sulfo aluminate, it varies, to 100 parts of Portland cement. So now we will discuss about the aggregates. Aggregates are inert material which are mixed with blending material such as cement or lime for manufacturing of mortar or concrete. Aggregates are used as filler in mortar and concrete and also to reduce their cost. So the aggregates which we use in concrete, these aggregates in concrete because we have to lower down the cost of the concrete. If we just use only fine aggregates, for example, or just use cement only, that doesn't make any sense because a concrete is a metric structure which contains aggregates, fine aggregate, coarse aggregate, fine aggregate, cement, and water. So the proper blending of these four different constituents of a concrete will make it a better concrete. So these aggregates, these are more or less are inert in nature and they used in a concrete, we use these in a concrete to as a filler material and as well as to lower down the cost of the construction. Now the sources of aggregate. So sources of aggregates are generally rocks. These rocks we found in nature are igneous rock, sedimentary rock and metamorphic rock. Igneous rocks are formed by the solidification of lava which comes out from the volcanoes. The sedimentary rock found in nearby the beds of rivers by the layer by layer sedimentation, sediment deposition of the sediments. and the metamorphic rocks, these are essentially the kind of sedimentary rocks only, but they are found in the huge depth, almost the depth of more than 5 kilometers from the ground level. So that's why these rocks, sedimentary rocks, will be converted into metamorphic rocks, which are far more strengthened, have a strength than sedimentary rock. So example of metamorphic rock is such as granite. Now the classification of aggregates. So now we are dealing with classification of aggregates. We will take discuss the classification with respect to the unit weight. So depending on the weight of this particle, aggregate particle, these are classified as lightweight aggregate, normal weight aggregate, and heavy weight aggregate. Generally we use in concrete normal weight aggregate, but sometimes we have to use the lightweight aggregates, which are made from the rocks which are lighter in weight and have a specific strength. But then these lightweight aggregates, when we use this lightweight aggregate into some for some building, then it will be specialized one. We generally use normal weight, and in day-to-day life or in maximum structures we use normal weight only. But in a prescribed way, or like if there is some sort of requirement of this kind of lightweight and heavyweight aggregates, we use this kind of aggregate to make a concrete for building purpose. Now, depending upon the size of the particle, aggregates are classified. So earlier we have seen the classification depending upon the weight. Now we are seeing the classification depending upon the size of the aggregate. So the size of the aggregate, fine aggregate, coarse aggregate. So the size of the aggregate, there will be fine aggregates and there will be coarse aggregate. So first we will discuss about fine aggregate. Fine aggregate, aggregate whose particle pass through 4.75 mm ISC are termed as fine aggregate. So the aggregate particles pass through 4.75 Indian Standard C are deemed as fine aggregate up to 75 micron. So they should get retained over 75 micron ISC and pass through 4.75 mm. So they are deemed as fine aggregate. Fine aggregates such as sand, pit or quarry sand, river sand or sea sand, whichever if it should be, and crushed stone in powder form, surkhi and ash or cinder. So these are the fine aggregates. So we will discuss number one, the fine aggregates. First of all, sand. It consists of small angular or rounded grains of silica depending upon the source from which it is obtained. Mainly we obtain sand from the river bed, the lakes or the ponds. So if we take the sand from let's say a quarry, so in that quarry or pit, it is found as deposited in soil and is to be excavated out. So from that pit or quarry, we have to excavate the sand. Its grains are generally sharp or angular. So when we excavate that, then the sand from there, the particles of that sand will be more angular and sharp. It should be free from organic matter and clay. When you excavate the sand from pit or quarry, we must take into our conscience that the matter, the organic matter which is stick to that sand should be taken out, or clay matter, organic clay should be taken out by proper washing of the sand after the quarrying. It is usually considered to be the best fine aggregate for use in mortar and concrete. So this kind of sand which is taken from quarry or pit is the best fine aggregate we can use for a concrete making. Now second is river sand. It is obtained from the banks and beds of rivers. It may be fine or coarse. Fine sand obtained from beds and banks of rivers is often found mixed with silt and clay. So it should be washed before use, but coarse aggregate sand is generally clean and excellent for use, especially for plastering. So if we take sand from river, we have if we take from river, we will find many things in river. For example, the rotten piece of woods and other organic waste. So to take this, after taking sand from there, we have to just wash that sand. When the sand can be of finer particles or the coarser particle, we have to take them and have to wash them and then use for the concrete making. So if we have the coarser sand particles, that coarse sand particles will be best used for the plastering purpose. Third is sea sand. It consists of fine rounded grains of brown color and it is collected from sea shores or sea beaches. Sea sand usually contains salts, and while using that in mortar, it causes disintegration of the work in which it is used. So the soil sand which we take from the beaches, it contains the film or the cover of salts which are present in the sea water. So before taking into use for this kind of sand, we have to thoroughly wash this sand into the fresh water to take out all these salts from soil film over the sea sand, and then this sand can be used as a filler material in the concrete. So in RC work, these salts will attack reinforcement if salt content is high. So if we directly use this sea sand, then this sand, the sulfate present in this will attack directly the RC work, the RC inside, and it will just start the corrosion and the sulfur attack. So both can happen when this salt, the sand from the beaches or sea shores are directly taken without washing to make a concrete or to make a some structural element. So another is stone dust. It is obtained by crushing the waste stones of the quarries to the particular size of sand. Sand obtained from the crushing by crushing a good quality stone in a slim fine aggregate mortar made with this sand is usually used for ashlar work. So we can make the sand from the aggregates by crushing it into the same size as sand has, and we can then use that into the mortar for especially for ashlar works or like for pointing purposes. So this stone dust is like the waste product of the aggregate quarries where we make aggregate. So this can be used for as a filler material in concrete. Cinder. It is a slag from a metal furnace. Before we use, we have to crush it to make its size at par with the fine aggregate, like we have to do in the stone dust also. Soot is finely powdered burnt clay made from slightly and completely burnt brick. So this sulki, which is fine powder burnt clay made from slightly and completely burnt brick. So we have seen the cinder and sulki, which are cinder essentially a slag which is a byproduct or like the waste product, and sulki we have the burnt brick, the powder of burnt brick. Now the coarse aggregates. Aggregates whose particle do not pass through 4.75 mm ISC are termed as coarse aggregates. Most commonly used coarse aggregates are crushed stone, gravel, broken piece of burnt brick. So the aggregates which retained on 4.75 or do not pass on 4.75 mm ISC are termed as the coarse aggregates. These are the most commonly used coarse. The most commonly used coarse aggregates are the crushed stone, gravel, and the broken piece of burnt brick. So these are the few things we use as the coarse aggregate apart from the crushed stone, this burnt brick. So the types of coarse aggregate are stone ballast. It is an excellent coarse aggregate and is obtained by crushing granite, sandstone or grain limestone and all types of stones. Crushed stones are used for the construction of roads and railway tracks. For So for the use of for making the for the construction of roads and railways tracks, we generally use the crushed stone, crushed from the rock basalt or from the granite, whichever is cheaper. So mainly we have seen the railways use a different size aggregate, which is a basalt rock. But we can use granite as if it is not expensive, but basalt is the most most high quality rock we can use for railways and as well roads. So generally we use basalt if it is available locally within the boundary. Next is gravel. It is a very good aggregate. It is obtained from riverbed quarries and seashores. The gravel obtained from seashores should be well washed with fresh water before using, in order to remove the impurities, which may be clay, salt, silt, etc. It is commonly used in the preparation of concrete. So this gravel, is just the coarser particles which retained on 4.75, which are not deemed as fine aggregate but deemed as a coarse aggregate. We can use this kind of gravel or the aggregate for making of our concrete, and they are we can use this after washing, because they are we get them from the river beds, and the river bed, they may contain the silt and clay or whatever. We can wash it and then properly use it. The next is brick blast. It is also a good artificial source of coarse aggregate. It is obtained by breaking well burned bricks. It is generally used in lime concrete at places where aggregates from natural sources are either not available or are expensive. It can be used at places where low strength is required. So we can use the brick ballast or brick aggregates from the burnt clay. We can use it as the aggregates where the structure is not much important, like the boundary wall, the making of boundary wall. We can use this kind of aggregate, but we will not use the ballast because it will be expensive one. So we will use this kind of aggregate for making the boundary, especially for the non-important structure or unimportant structures. It should be watered well before the using. It is the preparation of concrete. So we have to water it well because it will absorb some water as it is made from the burnt brick. So we have to water this before using so that it will not take water from the concrete. It is commonly used for mass concrete in foundations and underfloor. So we use this this type of aggregate which we get from the breaking of the burnt brick under the floors and in the foundations. Clinker, it is the byproduct of the industrial work. So clinker is a byproduct of industrial, various industrial works, and we use this as an aggregate for, especially for the floor, underfloor and the foundation purposes, for not that much important structures. So we have seen, we have studied the types of cements by ASTM C150, and then we've seen the aggregates, its classification based on weight, size, and in the next class we'll further study the classification based on the shape of the aggregates. Thank you.